Hi, I'm Nicola, and after my last project, I wanted to take on a harder challenge, and since I wanted to improve some flaws my previous rocket had, I decided to implement more precise yaw, pitch, and even roll control by using three motors that can thrust vector independently, just like the Space Shuttle did for its pitch roll maneuver, or like Starship does when landing, since they can't always take advantage of aerodynamic surfaces. In this video, I'm going to walk you through the design and thought process behind it, the failures I encountered and overcame, how I designed a control algorithm to coordinate the three motors, and how it turned out to be more powerful and versatile than I initially thought, providing, for example, control over the rocket, even if one of the engines didn't ignite. But really, the algorithm I developed is usable for many other applications, like choosing the right thrust and motor inclination for a multi-motor rocket, or even for a Mars lander. The first wall I encountered was that I couldn't find any documentation about an algorithm that did this, so I had to learn, grab what knowledge I had, and put it together to see if it would work. But let's go over the mechanical design first. I started by sketching the geometries to see if they were doable in a reasonable space, and after many hours, I came up with this first iteration. The concept is to have a servo rotating the thruster about an axis, then another servo rotating the whole thing about a perpendicular axis. And repeating the process three times, we get to a system with three motors that can thrust vector independent from each other. Then I went on and printed these black and gray parts out of PLA and assembled them with some printed pins that allowed for relative rotation. Then I printed this yellow motor casing and assembled it, and then I screwed the servos in, connected them to the 3D printed parts with some 1.1 millimeter iron wire, and calibrated their 0 and 90 degrees position. But if you wanted to start your own project, but didn't own a 3D printer, you could check out the sponsor of this video, PCBWay. They offer 3D printing services, and you just need to upload your design to their website. Select the material you want your part made out of, from plastics to even titanium, and they will get it done for you. And if you didn't want to go through the hassle of making such a circuit yourself manually, you could also check out their PCB services. You just need, again, to upload your design to the website and select between different parameters. They can also source and assemble the components on top of your PCB if you couldn't do it yourself. And for new members, they also offer a $5 coupon with which you can get your first 10 PCBs done for free. But now, back to the video. Then connecting the whole thing to an Arduino showed some great results. But you might be wondering, how am I deciding to move these motors? So at the same time of developing the physical design, I also started thinking about how to move the motors to actually achieve stabilization. But first of all, torque is a vector that represents the effect of a force on a body's rotation. And if I have a body rotating, you could guess that to make it stop rotating, I would want to apply a torque on the axis of its angular momentum, but in the opposite direction, since in this case the torque would be the derivative of the angular momentum. So now I just needed to ask myself the simple right questions, and so I divided the stabilization problem into two smaller ones. The first is finding the required torque, meaning the best possible torque I would want to apply to the rocket to stabilize it, while the second problem will be how to move the motors to actually achieve that wanted torque. And practically it means to make the required and provided torque match. But let's start from finding the required torque. To find the required torque, I use the PID controller algorithm, where to achieve stabilization, you combine a proportional, integral, and derivative part of the error with respect to the wanted state, in my case the rocket in a vertical still position. And these three components, in my case, will take shape of angular accelerations, since it's the way I can act on my rocket. First, the derivative part we'll try to cancel out the body's rotation. And to do that, we will want to apply an angular acceleration opposite to the angular velocity to cancel it out. While to get the proportional part, that is the angular acceleration that tries to bring the rocket to a vertical position, I first integrated the rotations over time to get the Earth frame with respect to the rocket's frame, and this can be done with either quaternions or rotation matrices, and through some math found the axis of rotation between the two frames. So you could imagine that ideally I want to rotate the rocket about that axis, so I decided the proportional part to be a vector along that axis with length equal to the angle of rotation between the two frames. Then, luckily, the integral part comes out to be just the integral over time of the proportional vector I just described. The combination of these three vectors gives us a total wanted angular acceleration, so it needs to be passed through Euler's equation to convert it to a required torque. After that, I built and ran a MATLAB simulation on Simulink by feeding a rocket this required torque, and I was relieved seeing that it was very well able to point the rocket upwards and control the roll, even with great initial instabilities. But remember that this is just the perfect torque we would want to apply, and I still had no idea on how to move the motors to achieve this correction. So now I was left with the second question of how to move the motors to achieve this torque. That practically means to find a way to make the provided torque match the required one we just found through the PID controller. First of all, we find the individual torque provided by each of the engines by knowing the position of the center of mass, how they are rotated, and the force provided. And then by performing a cross product between R and F. Then by summing all of the torques, we find the total provided torque as a function of the 6 servo angles, 2 for each of the engines. And now, by taking the distance between the provided and required torque, we are left with the function of the 6 motor angles. And if we could minimize this distance function to 0, that would mean that the provided and required torque would match, achieving stabilization. And to minimize this distance function, there are multiple ways, but my first idea was to go with gradient descent, an algorithm where you calculate the slope or derivative of a function with respect to a parameter in order to figure out where it is descending, and then take a step towards that descent. And although this method technically works, in the simulation, the blue dot, that is the gradient descent iteration, tended to follow behind the true minimum solution, that is moving around. And this brings to a delayed response and eventually an oscillation disaster. But other than an imprecise control, there were still some problems I needed to address. For example, the event of a misignition of one of the engines would be catastrophic for the flight, tilting the rocket on the side and making it crash. Not to mention that the algorithm I initially wrote was very slow. So at this point, with an algorithm that barely even worked, and the big consequences of a misignition, this project's idea started fading away, and I really considered if it was even possible to do at this scale. But I didn't give up and started thinking about some solutions for the mess I was in. The first thing I needed to do was finding a faster converging method for the distance function. And by studying it graphically for two parameters, I noticed that its shape was really similar to a paraboloid. So what I decided to do was to approximate this function to a second degree polynomial, and at each iteration, approximate the minimum to be the vertex of that parabola for each of the 6 angles. And if you're curious about it, this method just turns out to be Newton's method applied to the derivative of this function. Also, since we are working with rather small angles of about 10 degrees, we can replace the trigonometric functions with their Taylor expansion. And having a new algorithm, together with the fact that we are computing multiplications instead of trigonometry, turned out to be much faster. But unfortunately, this method has the downside that if it gets farther away from the solution, it tends to diverge and look for maximums, since the parabola concavity can be upside down. And to solve this aspect, I looked back at gradient descent and implemented what's called RMS propagation, an algorithm used all over machine learning that changes the step size dynamically using informations about past gradients. And as you can see, it can really take a more straightforward path towards the minimum. In the end, I use the hybrid of the two methods, using the parabola vertex when closer to the solution since it's faster and more precise, and using gradient descent when farther away to avoid divergence. While to avoid getting stuck in local minimums, if we know a very rough estimate of where the minimum should be, in my case around the zero position of the motor, we can add a parabola with a vertex on that point to the function we want to minimize, so that the gradient descent will avoid getting stuck in further away local minimums, evening them out. On the other hand, managing the misignition of one of the engines required more than a better algorithm, and what I really needed was a feedback on whether the engines were ignited or not. So I decided to implement some force sensors between the engine and their motor mount that would tell me if force was applied or not. And thanks to this, now I can scale the torque vectors according to this feedback, with the result of being able to ignore them unless ignition is detected and find the minimum with just the active ones. And the results of these changes are great. Stability is improved, and now the flight can go well even if one of the engines doesn't ignite, with the same exact code in the flight computer. And now I also realized I could take a step further and introduce attitude programs. Basically, what can now be achieved is injecting fake gyro data in the algorithm to actively control the rocket's rotation. For example, to induce a roll, injecting on the z-axis an angular velocity of 90 degrees per second for 1 second, we result in the rocket rolling 90 degrees and then stopping, making it easy to inject predetermined attitude programs. The same thing can be done for the yaw and pitch too, making it possible for the rocket to achieve any wanted orientation. And with a bit more of implementation, it could be expanded to following a certain trajectory. And this gave me the idea to try and do a roll turn of 90 degrees on the future launch to further validate the system. So now I went back to the mechanical design and made the motor mount much lighter and compact, and made this more aerodynamic casing, since my current idea is to make the whole thing stick out from the bottom of the rocket. And I also made some room for the force sensors and made these small discs that should go over the force sensors to kind of even out the force applied on them. But before even making a stability test by placing the rocket on a gyroscopic mount, I decided to do a static test to prove the thrust vector mount strength, the reliability of the ignition, and most importantly, calibrating the ignition detection through the force sensors. So now I just had to make a test computer, and I made this by using an ESP32 as a microcontroller unit, then an SD card slot for data acquisition, a radio receiver to receive the launch signal through this remote controller I made, and then other stuff like the gyroscope and accelerometer and connectors for the servos and the sensors. And I assembled the whole thing by using a perf board, then making all of the connections with stripped wires and then testing their connectivity. And luckily it worked right away, even when connecting the servos and uploading the control algorithm. So now I just had to do the test, and so I went to a field and set up a test stand by using a metal rack and connected the thrust vector control mount with this gray 3D printed part that gets bolted to the rack. And here's the first test footage. So as you just saw, the whole thing exploded and I was left with this pile of junk. And let me break down to you what exactly happened. The first critical mistake I did regards the motors. And basically, after removing the ejection charge from the back, I sealed the whole thing with hot glue, thinking it would have kept the hot gases coming out from the back into the thrust vector mount. But the exact opposite happened. I think either residual black powder or the ejection fuse ignited, and the hot glue made it possible to build up enough pressure for the motor to eject out and destroy the whole system. The second mistake regards the sensors. They were probably poorly attached, and since the motors were also press fit in their slot, most of the force was being transmitted through the yellow internal walls rather than on the first sensors. To fix this, I bought some sensors that had a sensitive range more suited to what I needed, and I also made the internal diameter of this part wider so that most of the force would transmit to the force sensors, and I also made these hooks so that the motor wouldn't fall out from below. The third mistake, and the reason why only two out of the three motors ignited, was that I connected the igniters in series, thinking they would have at least briefly kept continuity, but they ended up melting before the last one could ignite. And to fix this, I just had to connect them in parallel rather than in series. So after learning from my mistakes and fixing things, I also made some parts stronger on the critical points, and so I could go back to the field. And here's how the second test went. The test this time went great. All three motors ignited, nothing exploded, and the data collected from the force sensors are great. I probably won't be able to use them for exact thrust measuring, since you can see there's a little bit of offset between them, probably caused by how they are mounted or other stuff. But I can definitely use them to detect ignition, since the difference in time between when they turn on is clearly readable from the data collected. And that is great. But this project is still far from over. I still have to do the PCB flight computer, the parachute deployment, the inertia measuring, and even the rocket assembly. And even other stuff can be implemented in the control algorithm, for example, a required force to cancel out any horizontal velocity, for example, if you wanted to land your rocket. But other than that, I had a lot of fun developing all of this, and I can't wait to make the rocket and the launch itself. So I thank you for watching the video and stay tuned.